Okay, so if we're going to be working with metals in this class, it's a good idea to kind of get familiar with what metals are, sort of the nature of metals and why they behave the way they behave, so that we can take advantage of that. All right, so here is sort of a dictionary definition of metals. Metals are elements that give up electrons to form cations. They tend to be lustrous, conduct electricity, and are malleable and ductile. All right, so the first thing they're talking about here is that it's a particular type of element, and then it talks about how those elements behave. I don't know if you've ever seen, Theodore Gray has got a really good poster. TheodoreGray.com has got a really good poster on the elements, and if you ever have a look at that, you will see that just an awful lot of those elements are metals. And we'll break that down here in just a little bit. These are some examples of metals that I was able just to scrounge around without too much trouble. Mercury, zinc, tungsten, tin, lead. There's a piece of steel, and we'll talk a little bit about steel and copper. So these are ones that are used an awful lot in industry and some of the most common ones. All right, so it's starting on, it talks about our definition, talks about these metals being a particular type of element. So what we need to do is take a step back and refresh our memories of a little bit of elementary chemistry. So we're only going to hit the high points here. We're not going to talk about orbitals or anything like that. We're just going to talk about this as if the Bohr model is the way things are. It's kind of a good schematic anyway about the way things work. So what we have inside of a atom are inside here in the very middle is a thing called the nucleus. And inside the nucleus, we have these things, protons and neutrons. So let me just put a couple of those in there. Let me put one proton and one neutron in there in the nucleus of this atom. And then in the outer shell, I'm going to place an electron. Okay, so this is the very first shell. In the middle, we have the nucleus, and the nucleus consists of a proton, which has a positive charge, a neutron, which doesn't carry a charge, and an electron out here in the first orbital, or the first, the first shell. Now, you might know what this element is, some of you know this is hydrogen, but how do you know that it's hydrogen? And really, the only way that you know that this is hydrogen is not the number of neutrons, not the number of electrons. It is strictly the number of protons, okay? And in fact, what I could do is strip away this neutron inside here. I still have hydrogen, but what I've changed is the isotope of hydrogen that I have, okay? So what I have right now is protium, and that's a different isotope of hydrogen, but it's still hydrogen. Now I can put that neutron back in, and now I have something called deuterium. And in fact, I could take and have another neutron in there, and now I have what's called tritium. So if you've ever seen like much talk about the development of the atomic bomb and things like that, you may have heard of heavy water. Okay, and so heavy water is water made with hydrogen and oxygen, but the hydrogen is tritium. So that's changing the isotope. Now let me take one of these back out. And now let's strip away this electron, okay? Now what we've done is we've created an imbalance in the charge of this particular atom, and it now carries a positive charge. With the electron there, it balances out, so there's no charge attached to this. It's electrically neutral, okay? And if I were able to jam another electron out here, now it's carrying a negative charge. Those are ionizations. Okay, so if I take and strip away this this electron, now I have a cation. I have a positively charged atom. Okay, now I can advance to the next element by adding a proton. All right, so now I've got helium. I have some kind of isotope of helium. Let me balance this out completely and give myself a couple of neutrons, and maybe I need to make those look like they're more in the middle here. Whoops, that's not going to do it. There. Well, that's not it either. Close enough. And I want this helium to be nicely balanced out, so I'll put, whoops, not there. I'm going to put this electron out here in this first shell. Now, the first shell can hold two electrons. It maxes out at two, but with two, it's nicely balanced this way. Okay, so what I have here is a helium atom that is nicely balanced out. Okay, so I grabbed Wikipedia's periodic table and stuck it on here, and we'll see that there was hydrogen. We had that that one proton in the nucleus, and it tended to attract one electron into its outer shell. Then we had two protons, and it filled up that shell with two electrons in that first shell, and that means that we've used up this row. Okay, so now what we're going to do is we're going to add another shell and start filling it up. Okay, here's our next shell, and we got there by adding a proton. So let's add another proton in here. Let's balance that out with a neutron. Again, we don't have to, but just it's good housekeeping. We'll move this so it looks more like it's in the middle, and we'll start to add electrons into this outer shell. I'm just going to put it down here. Okay, we're just using this as a schematic. Now, this outer shell and all of the next outer shells that form, if they are the outer shell, they like to hold 8 electrons. And let me just jump back to this table. You'll see how that happens. We start off here with hydrogen. We went to helium. And notice that what this number up here is the number of protons in the nucleus. So we have two protons. Then we move to lithium. We have 3 protons in the nucleus. That next shell forms. Like I said, it likes to hold 8 electrons. And notice as we go across, we have 3, 4. That means we're going to have 2 electrons in the outer shell. And then 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And finally, with neon, it will have 8. Okay, so this is what helium would look like. It's got those 10 protons, 10 neutrons usually, unless it's some isotope. And then it's got 10 electrons. That means 2 in the inner shell and 8 in this outer shell. So that gives it octet stability. And that means by the time we've filled up to neon, we have reached the other side of the periodic table. Where is that thing? Let me get this back out. All right, so there's neon. So we've filled up that second shell. And let's jump down here to sodium. All right, so here is the thing. You see, sodium, we add this next shell, okay, and we start filling it up. Now, this is no longer the inner shell, and it's kind of important to point out that the inside shells no longer really need to have 8 so much. It is the outer shell that wants to either have 2 or 8 in it. That's sort of its favorite resting position is when once it has what's called octet stability, when it has these 8 electrons out in the outer shell. All right, so now we have this next shell added, but sodium has just this one lone electron out here. And I'm going to tell you that makes sodium feel a little bit self-conscious, because if it weren't for this one electron, you see, sodium could look just like neon. But instead, it's got this sort of albatross around its neck, this extra electron that it does not care for one bit. All right, so here's sodium on this side with one extra electron. If we look down way over here at this other side, chlorine, you see, is almost ready to look like argon. Let me just show you chlorine over here. So here's chlorine at the other side of the table, almost ready to have octet stability, but missing one electron, okay? And again, that makes chlorine feel a little bit self-conscious, because it could be one of these noble gases over here on this right-hand side of the table. So what will happen if you are to take chlorine and sodium and get them close to each other and give them a little bit of nudge of energy, you see, what will happen is sodium will say, get rid of this electron. And what will happen is sodium is now going to carry a positive charge. So it's going to carry a positive charge, the sodium. And over here, the chlorine, which starts off as being electrically neutral, will then get, and it will take hold and say, well, if you're not going to use that electron, I will certainly use it. And it will become negatively charged. Now, since these two are close together like this, and you know that opposite charges attract, there will be a bond that will want to form between these two. And the bond is because they have shifted the number of electrons that they have. In other words, they've become ions, all right? So over here, the sodium becomes a cation, and the chlorine becomes an anion. And the different charges will cause these two to attract. Now, since they are ions, what do you think is the type of bond that's formed like this? That's right, it's called an ionic bond, okay? So that comes from the attraction of these different charges, because this is an ion and this is an ion. And notice that we can say, look, this electron, it very clearly belongs to the chlorine. So sodium is happy because it gets to look kind of like neon on the outside, and chlorine is happy because it gets to look a little bit like argon on the outside. They both don't mind carrying a charge, and they join up to form this ionic bond. And we have sodium chloride here, which is table salt. All right, now while we're talking about bonds, let's have a look at another type of bond. Let's look at carbon. So carbon, inner shell, nicely filled. Outer shell, well, it's about midway between filled and not filled. Okay, and so carbon doesn't really have a strong desire to lose or gain electrons. It would like to look filled out, though. It would like to go ahead and have that complete look. And so here's what it does. We'll get this carbon around some hydrogen, maybe give it a little energy push. And what we can do is set up a sort of a timeshare agreement between the carbon and the hydrogen. And it would look something like this. Okay, so we've got the hydrogen and the carbon, and we have this electron that's sometimes it sort of seems to be attached to the hydrogen, and sometimes if we look at it, it looks like it's part of the carbon. And so this sort of, you see, it's in two different valence shells. So these outside shells are called valence shells, as I'm sure you're aware. And so these spend some of their time in either shell. So these are covalent. This is a covalent bond. And notice we can't say anymore that this electron belongs to hydrogen or that it belongs to carbon the way that we could with the ionic bond. And what's really neat about this special bond between hydrogen and carbon, and it's not just between hydrogen and carbon, but this one is a real good example of covalent bonding, is that now when you look at this, hydrogen, if we were to squint at it, it looks kind of like hydrogen, looks like helium on the outside. And if we look at the carbon, well, it looks like neon on the outside. So it has a nice filled valence shell here. And you can take these and completely fill this thing out with hydrogens and carbon. This is a particular hydrocarbon. So you may know of hydrocarbons as being really good fuels. And this one is methane. Okay, so you have different fuels. And what you can actually do, this is kind of like with Lego blocks, you can take this hydrogen here and you can rip it out and you can replace it. You can rip another hydrogen off of another carbon that's got some hydrogens bonded to it, and you can double these up, kind of like Legos. So this is an ethane molecule. And a simpler way to represent that, instead of drawing this picture every time, is to just come in here and just draw the carbons with the hydrogens stuck on there like that. So you can extend this out and keep adding these links in this chain. I think this one is this one is butane, the bastard gas. This one is pentane. And you can keep adding these out, and these hydrocarbon strings, you can keep stringing these along really just infinitely. You can have just long, long, long chains of these hydrocarbons. And a lot of these are kind of what form the backbone of plastics. Okay, so if we were to keep going with this and have, say, 20 or 30 of these hydrocarbon chains or these carbons linked together, then we start to wind up with hydrocarbons like paraffin. And the paraffin, if you keep adding carbon and hydrogen to it, you wind up with things like polyethylene. All right, so these are covalent bonds. Now, we're not talking about metals, are we? It sounds like we're talking about plastics and things like that. And I think it's important to understand these different bonds, ionic bonds and covalent bonds, to be able to understand what it is that makes metals metals. And that is the fact that they give up these electrons so awfully easily. Okay, and we saw sodium do it, but we saw sodium combine with chlorine, and if we take a metal and combine it with a non-metal, then we'll wind up with something that's not a metal anymore. Okay, so let's look at bonding just sodium to sodium. So what happens if we have just sodium? See, it doesn't like to hang on to this electron very tightly at all. So if we have a couple of sodiums, let's give ourselves four of them, then we have these electrons floating around in here, and nobody's really claiming them, see? Nobody really wants to take responsibility for these electrons as they float around in this, there's a sea of electrons that float around these sodium atoms. And this is the same for any metal. You've got the metal ions, the little cations that have given up ownership of that outer electron, and you wind up with so many of these outer electrons out here, and you've got these sodiums that have a plus one charge, so they are pulled in to this C of the opposite charge. And this is a metallic bond, okay? So this is what really the thing that makes metals metals. And let me just show you how this can work. You see, if I were to take and apply a force on this sodium structure, I could slide these sodium atoms completely out of position and shift them over one whole unit there, and they would still be bonded together. Okay, so I can actually, this is a nice plastic deformation where I can slide the metal past the other metal atoms, and they remain bonded together because of this affinity for this electron, the C of negative electrons floating around, and all of these plus one sodium ions are attracted in to this this sea of electrons. Okay, so I'm going to play through this periodic table and watch it fill up. And what you'll notice is, as we move across, the outer shell gets more and more filled with electrons. So let me stop that there. Let me back up just a little bit. And you see there, fluorine and neon, you start to fill this shell up. Okay, and it starts to get more and more filled with electrons, and as it approaches this side over here, it doesn't like to give up the electrons. It wants to attract, it wants to pull in electrons and fill that outer shell. But on this whole left side, and you'll see that all the way up to almost over here, there are very few electrons in the outer shell. So let me just play through this again. Notice here, when we're on the left side, we have very few in the outer shell. And as we move across, there's one. So there's one, two, 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 one, one, two. So on the left side, very few electrons in the outer shell. You'll notice we have more than eight on the inside shells as these fill up. But it's the outer shell where the chemistry happens. Okay, so there's one, two, one. So very few electrons in the outer shell for the things on the left side of the periodic table. And in fact, that's where the metals are. Okay, in fact, hydrogen's kind of an oddball. There are reports, sometimes reports of metallic hydrogen being made come out. And so there's really no reason it wouldn't fit in here. It does like to give up electrons, but it's not an easy thing to make metallic hydrogen. So we'll just kind of leave it alone. But everything else, from aluminum, gallium, tin, bismuth, all the way over, all of these are metals. And you'll notice these are different colors on this periodic table, and we'll talk a little bit about what those colors are. This first column, these are the alkali metals, okay? And there are some really good videos out, let me drop back up here. If you go out and watch this one, whose is this? So there's a link in the notes, but it's this Ironica, okay? This video is a pretty good, pretty accurate example of how reactive the alkali metals are. So as you go down this table, lithium, sodium, potassium, these, you may have seen this demonstrated in a high school chemistry class, but if you take a chunk of sodium and it's really soft, you can cut it with a knife. You can cut it and you drop it into a dish of water, it will react pretty violently with the water, and it will actually burst into flames. So sodium, potassium, even better. It'll make a nice purple flash. But as you go down this table, they become more and more reactive, and that's just they're trying to shed off that one electron in their outer shell to look more like they belong in the noble gas column over here. The next column over are the alkaline earth metals, and these have sort of similar behavior. If you put these in water, they will react, okay? Like calcium, you may not think of calcium even as being a metal because, it, you know, you always think of it as being sort of a chalky substance because it will react so easily that it's not usually found, well, it's not found in nature as a metallic material. Magnesium is used as a metal, but it's actually flammable. So a magnesium, you have a magnesium engine block or something, like Volkswagen made engine blocks out of magnesium years ago. It will actually burn, so you can catch magnesium on fire, and it will burn. There's some other metals that will do that pretty easily, too. Titanium is an example of one that burns fairly easily. Then you get to this big group in the middle. These are the transition metals, and for our purposes, let me grab a different diagram. Well, I'm just going to go with this. So for our purposes, we'll actually consider this entire middle section. We're not going to deal with the lanthanides and the actinides in this class, and this bottom row down here, these super heavies. We're not going to get into those. But we're going to consider everything in the middle here to be transition metals. Different texts will group out this column. Some will group them in with this post-transition or other or poor metals, which we'll talk about in a bit. We're just going to consider them as being part of the vast middle ground here. And these are the transition metals. Okay, so the transition metals, it sort of sounds like maybe they're not quite metals because of the name, but that's not true. They are sort of the classic metals, you know, things like gold, silver, copper, iron, chromium. You know, the real sort of textbook metals are found in this middle ground here, the transition metals. Then last of all, we'll talk about these over here on the side. These are the post-transition, or sometimes called poor metals, things like aluminum, tin, lead. These tend to be very soft. In fact, you know, you might think, well, why would aluminum, if it's a poor metal, why would it be used so much? And that's because it's not used as a pure metal very often at all. It's very weak and ductile and malleable as a pure metal, but when you start adding things like silicon to it, it becomes a really high performance metal. So the alloys of aluminum, just like the alloys of iron, like we call steel is the, sort of the classic iron-based alloy, those alloys, when we start combining and mixing in other elements, we can get performance characteristics that are much better than a pure element, or at least better for certain purposes. All right, let's start talking about the crystal structure of metals. That is the arrangement that metals make. You don't normally think of metals as being a crystal. You know, you think of like quartz and things like that as being crystals, you know, diamond. But it turns out that metals actually have a crystalline structure. And what happens is, at the very sort of the atomic level, these atoms will put themselves together in a very nice, regular, repeating way. And the base cell of that repeating unit is called the unit cell. All right, so this unit cell repeats over and over again, and you wind up with a lattice structure. And it's important to talk about three of these structures, okay? There are more than these three, but these, if you understand these three, and we'll add a fourth one later on when we talk about heat treating, but if you understand these three lattice structures, then you understand how most metals are put together. All right, so the first two of these are cubic structures. All right, so this is we have a cube here, and the first one is body-centered cubic. So we'll take that cube, and in the center of that cube body, we will place an atom, okay? And then at all of the corners of that cube, we'll also place an atom. Okay, so the atoms around the outside, they form a cube, and then right in the middle of that, in the body, is another atom. So this is called body-centered cubic, or BCC. The next one is also a cube, so we take our cube, and then instead of putting a atom in the body, we're going to put an atom on each of the faces. All right, so that one goes on the center of that face, and we'll just put one atom on each of the faces. That one's not there yet. So we have one atom on each of the faces, and then we have an atom on each of the at each corner of the cube. All right, so this is face-centered cubic, and you can see this is a different structure. And you can also notice that the spaces in between are going to change. Okay, so the size between those different spaces, the interstitial spaces, is that amount of space is going to change as well. And there's one more, and this one is not a cube shape, it's a hexagon shape. Okay, so you see these atoms in this case are arranged in a hexagonal arrangement. I'll turn these on. Alright, so this is hexagonal close packed. So they're hexagons, but then each row of hexagons nests into the spaces of the hexagon above it. And so this makes a hexagonal structure. So this is HCP, or hexagonal close packed. So these face, body-centered cubic, face-centered cubic, and hexagonal close packed, these are the three structures that you need to know right now, be able to recognize them, you know, from an image. All right. All right. So we'll talk a little bit about mechanical properties. This is a really good image by this GrantaDesign.com. And what I like to, the way I like to set this up is, let's say that you were on the beach, okay, and a genie comes up to you. You know, you find a lamp, and you start cleaning the lamp. This genie comes out of this lamp on the beach and pulls out this chart and says, I will give you the formula for a material anywhere on this chart, okay? And he will let you put your pen down at one spot on this chart. So take a second and look at that chart and see if you know where to put the pen down. All right, time's up. If it were me, I'd put it somewhere over here, okay? Because if I were to put something right here, if I had the formula to make a material that was as lightweight, so this is density along this axis, so it's as dense as foam, some kind of polymer foam, like, well, there's cork, okay? It has the density of something like cork, nice and lightweight, and yet it's as strong as titanium or steel, then I would have something that I could, you know, I'd be able to retire comfortably, okay? Because this axis is strength, so I have something that's as strong as steel, but as dense as cork. So one reason I do like to show this diagram is because when you first look at it, it looks like it's really confusing. And we're going to have some diagrams in this class that maybe are a little unfamiliar to you. So I'd like to remind you, first of all, to start by reading. See what the units are, okay? These are units of mass per unit volume. This is density, so that tells you something. This is strength. Now, these are units that look like pressure units, okay, megapascals. It could also be given in pounds per square inch, PSI. And we'll talk about why we talk about strength in terms of units that look like pressure. This is stress units is what they are. They're a force divided by a cross-sectional area. All right, so look at the units. And the units will help you to understand. See what the different axes are. Notice these are logarithmic axes. So as you increase in either direction, you get in very rapid, large increases. But also to show you that metals are actually pretty much on the cutting edge out here. They are in very high strength and competitive with other products, okay? Like we're up here in higher strength than any of these things like PEEK and PET. These are polymers. These are plastics, for instance. Notice that the highest performance stuff with the highest strength and the least weight up here are composites. But just see that the metals are still pretty competitive with that stuff there, with those products, ceramics and composites. But really, if strength to weight ratio is everything, then you want carbon fiber, and that's kind of where it's at right now. All right. Now let's talk about that strength a little bit more, okay? And the way that we will evaluate strength, or one measure of strength, is the tensile strength of a metal. So the tensile strength of a metal is the strength as you pull on the metal. So if we did the opposite of that, if we push on it, it would be compressive strength. But this is tensile strength, where we pull on a metal specimen, and what we're going to do is we're going to measure the amount of force that we pull. All right, so that force can be in newtons, or it can be in pounds. Sometimes we use the units of kips, which are thousands of pounds. So if you see the word kips, that's referring to a 1,000 pounds. Okay, so you just take the number of pounds and multiply it by 1,000. So we're going to take that force and we're going to divide by a cross-sectional area. All right, now I'm not going to explain to you how to find the cross-sectional area, but if it's a rod shape, like a cylinder shape, you should know that the area is pi times the radius squared. The formulas for area you should know at this point, and I'll just tell you that you should know them for a round shape or for a square shape or rectangular shape as well. All right, and the units for area are going to be square units of length, okay? So keep in mind that you can't convert inches to square inches. They are different quantities altogether. So these are going to be given in millimeters squared or square meters or square inches. Okay, and that will give us stress. So we take the force, divide by the cross-sectional area, just like this, and that will give us this quantity of stress. And stress is going to be one way that we measure strength. And we saw earlier those strength values were in megapascals. We could also say PSI or KSI. One of my favorite ways, even though people are not going to like this, is to remember PSI, because PSI, pounds per square inch, actually gives you the formula for stress. Okay, so these look like pressure units. It's the same idea, where you take a force and divide by a cross-sectional area, but it's a different type of quantity. Okay, so PSI, pounds force, divided by a cross-sectional area, pounds per or over square inches. And this little symbol is a lowercase sigma. That's going to be our symbol for stress. All right, so here's how our tensile test runs. We take and put the sample in the machine, and we will start to pull it apart. Okay, so we apply a load to this thing. I'll skip along here. And you'll notice that as we apply that load, this bar, you can kind of see it now, it's starting to spread apart. It's starting to get longer. All right, so this is a bar of brass, and you can see it's stretching pretty easily. Well, not easily. There's several thousand pounds of force doing this, but it's able to do it. Okay, it is ductile. It can flow like this. Now you see it start to neck down right like that, and then finally, bang! It's all over. So if you haven't seen a tensile test in action, you might not be aware of the fact that metals can flow. Some metals can flow so much as you apply load to them. Okay, so we've seen what happens when the stress builds up. Okay, now here's what we're going to do on the actual test is we're going to take and put two marks on our specimen, and let's say we're using let's use pounds, and we'll go with inches squared, and we'll go with inch units, okay, and we'll get PSI. So what we're going to do is we're going to compare stress and something else that happens here. Okay, we're going to look at a thing called strain. I'll go ahead and write the equation out for strain, and then I'll talk about what it means. Okay, so strain is this delta L. That means a change in length divided by the original length. All right, so our original length here is going to be 2 inches. So for our experiment, we could just plug 2 in. And as we stretch this out, we'll take this thing and we'll stretch it out. As we stretch it out, we'll have a change in length. So the amount of length that we add is going to be the change of length. Okay, so let's say that we stretched it out 0.2 inches. You'll notice one thing is that this whole thing got a little bit skinnier as we stretched it out, but we'll talk about that in just a minute. But we've stretched it out. This is the change in length. This is the delta L would be the 0.2. So if we went from 2 inches, what was 2 inches, if we read it now and it says that it's 2.2, like that, then we know that our change of length is 0.2. So you need to be able to draw this diagram based on what you're given in a problem and understand what's the original length, what is the new length, that's the new length would be 2.2, and what is the change of length. In fact, sometimes you'll see this this formula written like this, where you have L1 minus the original length divided by the original length. That is the thing called the strain. All right, so when you take the change of length, which is easier to say, the 0.2, and divide by the 2 inches, the change in length, that would give us an overall strain of 0.1. Okay, so our strain is the change in length, that is the 0.2, divided by the original length, that's our 2 inch original length or gauge length, and that will equal 0.1. Now we talked about these units, the units of stress being something like PSI or KSI. Over here we have inches, and we divided by inches. Just like when you multiply inches together to get square inches, when you divide inches by inches, you no longer have inches. Okay, you've divided something by itself gives you one. So the units will disappear on the strain. Now sometimes you'll see them written something like mm per mm, or you might see inches per inch, something like that, to remind people where the units went. But it doesn't matter what our units of length were over here. It would always wind up, the strain would be the same, okay? It might not be 2 inches over 2 inches. It might be some number of millimeters, almost, 50 or so millimeters divided by 5 millimeters, something like that. It will wind, 5 millimeters divided by 50. It will wind up being the same value of strain because the units disappear. The units go away. So you might be wondering what strain, what's so useful about this. And the fact is that we can actually, if we measure these two things as we do a tensile test, you see for each value of strain, as we move at each little increment of strain, as we stress that bar out, if we were to see how much stress is generated in that sample at that time, we can plot a really nice diagram and understand an awful lot about how this metal behaves and the properties of this metal by plotting these two. Now, if we were to do this, we would wind up with this axis would be the stress that gets generated. This axis would be the strain. Okay, so this is stretching in this axis, and this is stress building up, force per unit area building up. And what we would notice as we were measuring these is, as we first started the tensile test, as we first start to pull on this sample, this thing's going to skyrocket immediately. It's going to go up very rapidly, and it will go up in a straight line. This is called elastic deformation, and what it looks like, if we were to look at this under a microscope that's beyond the capabilities of microscopes we have, is it would show the atoms not moving out of their position, but the atoms getting further and further apart from each other. The distance between from one atom to the next would start to increase. But we could remove the load. We could let this strain go back to zero. We could let the stress drop down to zero, and the specimen would be unchanged until we hit a point right here, okay? And at that point, our diagram is going to take on a different look, okay? This is not the greatest stress-strain diagram there. It should look something like that. At this point right here, all of that changes. This is called the yield point, all right? And notice that we will... We put a point right there. We're going to talk about that yield point in terms of how much stress was happening at the time when this transition occurred. All right, and so this will be the yield stress we'll talk about. All right, so at this quantity of stress, the atoms actually start to move out of their position, and they are permanently dislocated. And if we were to stretch this much, and stretch the part out this far and inflict this much strain on it, then when we let go of that, here's what will actually happen. It will return back to zero, but there will be some permanent E left in here. That's some permanent strain. Remember, this is stretching. So when we let go, it will return not to its original length. It will return to a stretched length. It will wind up looking something like this. It will be longer than it was when we started. So this whole region, this is called plastic deformation, the type of deformation that happens along here. And you can see this is a lot of stretching. Okay, this is a lot of change of length compared to the original length. All right, and you can think about that. You know, if it's a change of length divided by some constant, then we could just talk about this in terms of stretching. All right, so this is stretching that you're seeing happening here. This is stress building up. This is stretching happening. Now, what will happen is that that stress, that curve, will reach a maximum point here. Okay, it will reach a point. I don't think I actually got the maximum there. There, it will go to there. It will be the, it will peak out right there. Okay, and that is going to be called the ultimate tensile strength. Let me just put that, put a label on it there. The UTS. All right, and it's going to get stress units as well, just like our yield strength did. Okay, so we have our yield strength. Let me go ahead and label that. And our ultimate tensile strength. A lot of times people will be, you got to be careful and make sure that you know whether people are talking about the yield strength or the UTS, because both of these are measures of tensile strength. I will say in general, when people talk about, if they just say tensile strength, generally they mean the UTS, but for design purposes, you have to know specifically what they're talking about without any doubt. All right, now, something else that's really important that you can see from this is the slope of this curve, okay? So if we did two separate tests on two different types of materials, we might have one material that looks like this and the other one looks like that. There's a very important distinction in those two, okay? And that has to do with the slope of this line. So the slope of this line, the rise over the run, is a thing called Young's modulus, okay? And it's represented by E because it is a modulus of elasticity, all right? But this is Young's modulus. We're doing a tensile test, and we're evaluating Young's modulus. A higher Young's modulus value would look more straight up, like that, okay? A higher Young's modulus, as you can, if you can think about it, but this from this diagram, would be a stiffer material. Okay, so there are different things that make a material stiff, and one of them comes from the material itself, okay, and that is Young's modulus. This is two separate bars. This is a bar of steel and a bar of aluminum. So what I've done is held everything else constant. They're both clamped at the exact same length, and they both have the exact same cross section, and they're both oriented the same way. And so that means that what you're going to see is the difference in Young's modulus between these two materials. All right, so you can see that the aluminum has got a lower Young's modulus than the steel. The steel is a stiffer material than the aluminum. All right, so what you're seeing in that demonstration is the difference in Young's modulus between the two materials. Okay, so some things that you should understand at this point is this is a stress strain diagram. We apply a stress, in this case a tensile stress, to pull on the bar. Stress is defined as force per unit area. We talked about those units. Then there is strain, that is the change in length over the original length. We talked about Young's modulus, and you could rearrange stress and strain to get this. This is the rise over the run. This is the elastic region. This is the plastic region. All right, our yield point happens there, and our ultimate tensile strength is at the top of the diagram. All right, we saw elastic deformation happening in that nice straight part of the curve. We saw that's elastic deformation happening there. We saw plastic deformation happening across here as the strain becomes permanently ingrained in the material, as the material is permanently deformed. Since this deforms so plastically, we would call this a ductile material, all right, because we're able to pull on it, and it doesn't just snap, it's able to elongate. So that's a ductile material. Let's see, then there's another thing called toughness that we need to talk about. All right, toughness is the ability of a material to absorb impact. So if we were to take a little test specimen like this, a little piece of the material, and put a notch in it, and then clamp it down so that we're holding it securely in a vise. So I'll just put a little vise on here. All right, so we're clamping onto it like this. The way this test works is we'll just take this thing and we'll hit it with a hammer, okay? So our hammer will have a pivot point up here, and it will have a mass on it. So let me just take this hammer and rotate it back a little bit. Not that much. There we go, about like that. All right, so if we have this hammer, we rotate it back like this. We know a couple of things about this hammer. Let's say, first of all, that we know how much it weighs. All right, so if we know how much it weighs, and we know how high it is from here to its rotated position like this, this is our height. All right, so if we know how much this hammer weighs, we know its mass, and we know how high it is, what does this look like? This looks like an illustration of potential energy, maybe, okay? So we know that we've got mgh of energy on this hammer. All right, so let's, if we just let the hammer flow freely through here without putting our specimen in yet, then it would rise on this other side to the same height, or almost the same height, that it was on this other side. Let's eliminate friction and things like that. All right, so if this thing swings freely, then it ends at about the same height that it started, and so there was no loss of energy, only just very small things like the energy that's lost to the air current and things like that. But if we let it swing, and maybe it is a little bit less on this side, we'll just mark it as zero. So this is how high it would swing with no specimen in the fixture. Now, if we put a very tough material in here, then when this hammer swings, it will whack into our specimen and pull a lot of energy out of that system. So this hammer will not rise nearly as high on the other side. And so what we have is we have the difference in MGH between the hammer that swings freely and the one that goes here. So that gives us a direct measure of the amount of energy that this specimen was able to absorb. By the same token, if we have a very brittle material, this hammer will swing through and just snap it in two without losing much energy at all. So what we'll have on the hammer will actually be a scale of how much energy was lost as the hammer swung. That is the measure of toughness. Okay. Now let's come back here and look at our diagram. And toughness on this diagram is actually the area under this curve. Okay. So the area under the curve, if we have a lot of area under this curve, then we know that we have a very tough material. It's able to absorb a lot of impact. Notice that we can kind of get that two ways. One is by growing in the tensile strength direction, and one is by growing in the ductility direction. And what we'll see then later on is that a lot of times there's a big trade-off between hardness and toughness. But oops, I haven't talked about hardness yet. So what the heck is hardness? All right. Hardness is the ability of a material to resist indentation and the way that we, or scratching. All right. So the way that hardness is measured in the machines is to take either a little tiny ball shape. Well, it doesn't have to be tiny. It could be a Brinell size, but it could be about a BB size or a little shot size, a little tiny carbide ball, or a diamond, a pointy diamond, and try to push those into the material, okay? And if you can't push those in the material very hard, very far, then it's a hard material. And if it goes in very easily, then it's a soft material. So this is indentation hardness testing. This is how we evaluate the hardness of a material. And like I said, there's often a trade-off between this toughness and hardness. So you get hardness as you increase tensile strength, but you get toughness as you go out in both directions. But generally, as you move up in tensile strength, you start losing this ductility and you start losing hardness. And so really, that relationship between hardness and toughness is one of the most essential relationships to know about if you're going to be machining metals. All right, so I did talk about ductility. And I talked about ductility mostly because we were dealing with a tensile test. So ductility, you hear about ductility and malleability used kind of interchangeably, but in this class there's a small distinction, and that is that ductility happens in tensile forces. So it's the ability of a material to flow under tensile stresses, and malleability is the ability of the material to flow under compressive or pushing forces or stresses. And then creep resistance is something that most metals are pretty good at, and that is the ability not to flow very slowly under a load. So if we have our tensile test here, if we were to just apply a certain force on this thing, this happens pretty much in real time. But if we were to hold, say, 10,000 pounds of stress, or 10,000 psi of stress on a part, and it were to slowly creep and increase its length, then that would be strain. So strain happens in a longer time frame than a test like this that happens kind of in real time. This is an excellent little video on a process called impact extrusion. Impact extrusion, if you're not familiar with it, you should look that up, and you see just how some metals are able to flow. So this is how scuba tanks are made, and compressed air tanks are made out of aluminum. The press comes in here and mashes this little billet workpiece and just turns it into a can shape. It's pretty amazing. All right. I'm going to pick and choose some other physical properties that I think are really important to this class. We will talk a little bit about melting point and muddy the waters there a little bit, so I'm gonna not talk about that right now. But the coefficient of thermal expansion is something that's pretty important to machining, because if your tool is getting hot and it's changing size, that's going to affect the size of your part. And remember, we're talking about precision work here. This is an example. This is over in Shelby Farms. Some of you may have seen this. It's out in a field. It's a plaque. And what happened, this plaque is not supposed to look like a book page or something. What happened here is that the aluminum of this plaque has a higher coefficient of thermal expansion than the steel does. And what happened is this thing got hot and it was restrained out here at the sides, and actually is now permanently set like this. This could have been avoided by either using a plaque that's the same material as the podium or the thing that it's attached to, or you could have slotted these attachment holes here. Okay, so if you see, just having different materials, you can expect things like this. But the main point is that as metals get hotter, they will tend to get larger. They will tend to grow, but they grow at different rates. And that can be really important, especially if you're doing something like machining, say, titanium. Titanium has a low coefficient of thermal expansion. And if you're drilling a piece of titanium with a steel drill bit and it's all getting hot, and trust me, if you're machining titanium, it's going to get hot, then your drill bit will grow at a faster rate than the material that you're drilling, and that's just a recipe for disaster. Other things here that are somewhat important for different processes, a lot of these come into play more with processes too, but there's some high points that I wanted to hit. And that is, we need to start drawing a distinction between oxidation and corrosion, because they are not always the same thing. So, you know, a lot of times people will talk about rust and say, oh, that's oxidation. And then people say, well, what's oxidation? Well, that's rust. Well, it just so happens that this is also oxidation. Okay, so this oxidation happened, but it's not a detrimental thing. In fact, this oxidation was grown artificially on here. And it was filled with a blue dye in this case and a red dye in this case. That oxidation comes about from a process called anodization. So when you anodize something like aluminum, it will grow a layer of oxidation that's porous, and then you can put a dye into that porous structure and then seal it with boiling water, and you'll wind up with a nice permanent, very hard aluminum oxide coating on your parts. All right, so that's pretty much it for this lecture, but I did talk about some equations and things in here. You will need to understand those, and none of the math is really difficult math. It's just understanding the concepts, but being able to do the math points out that you understand the concepts.